Church. How is everybody doing?
Good.
Well, good. It is a pleasure to be here, and I'm excited to worship with all of you this morning. As we begin, let's just go over a couple of quick announcements. We are doing a take-home or at-home vacation Bible study, or Bible study, Bible
school.
Let me start over. Vacation Bible school. And so if you would sign up, if you want your children to come, we'll do them for just about any age. And I think that's the 16th is the deadline, correct, Michelle? So the 16th is the deadline for registration. We hope to have all of those put together by the 22nd or 23rd of August so that you can do those. So please help us out by doing that and getting those kids registered. If you have any questions, feel free to contact us here in the office. Secondly, some of us got to experience the Global Leadership Summit this past week, and that was just, at least for myself, an amazing experience. And so we're able to have a few people here that did that. So Mary Ann and Michelle and Kyle and Aaron were all part of that. And so and Eric too, I'm sorry, I left him out. He's just like, so yeah, go around, ask those people about their experience. It was wonderful, and I'm excited to have done that. All right, are there any other announcements this morning that anyone would like to share or lift up? All right. Well, seeing none, then let us continue. And so, again, a welcome to all of you that are watching online, whether you're on Facebook Live or joining us via a YouTube recording. We're glad that you could spend a little bit of time with us this morning. If you're brand new to us, welcome, and we encourage you to connect with us via our website, our Facebook page, or our YouTube channel, and there are the titles of each one of those resources, so feel free to connect with us. We'd love to meet you, we'd love to pray for you, and journey alongside of you as we go through this time today. All right, so with that, I invite us to just prepare our hearts and minds for worship this morning. Hear these centering words. Lead me from despair to hope, from fear to trust. Lead me from hate to love, from war to peace. Let peace fill our hearts, our world, our universe. Peace, peace. At this time, I invite you to join me in our call to worship, and please respond to the words in bold. Come with your doubts and your fears.
This is scary.
Call on God, who will answer you.
God is hard to hear these days.
Come to the one who will give your souls peace. It's so hard to believe. Come, claim your identity as beloved children of God. Amen. At this time, I invite you to join us in singing our opening song, God Will Take Care of You.
Thank you.
Pixar's movie, The Inside Out, and this movie came out in 2015, but for our young disciples, what do you see in the picture up there? Cashin, you're kind of my only hope today, bud. I don't see any other really young disciples. All right, so you see some characters, and they represent some of our emotions, right? Disgust, fear, joy, sadness, and anger. All right, Cashin, have you ever gotten mad at anything?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Pretty sure that all of us have. Have you ever been scared of anything?
Yes.
Yeah, what are you scared of?
Bears.
Bears? You know, I've got a little fact that probably not very many people know, but you know what I'm scared of? Spiders.
Oh.
I really don't like those little eight-legged creatures. I mean, I like what they do. I'm really glad that God put them there to eat all those bugs, but the thought of them crawling around or biting me just makes me not want to be very close to them. All right? So how do you think that we can overcome our fears or use our anger in a good way, Cashin? You got any ideas? Do you think we could maybe pray to God?
Yes.
Yes. And so today we're going to talk in our message portion of our worship service about how we can do that. Okay? And so it's really important that we remember that these emotions that we have are natural. And it's okay to be scared. And it's okay to be angry. But we have to allow God to use those emotions in the right way so that we don't hurt other people or we don't make poor decisions in our lives. Now, all of us at some point, if you've had kids or grandkids, you know some of the emotional displays that kids have, right? And we always kind of laugh at them and go, my goodness, you know, we really need to correct that. Well, I'm going to say for many of us adults, we do the same thing, just a little bit differently, all right? And so we are going to continue on in our series, The Songs of Summer. And we're going to spend time discussing how we can allow God to redirect our fear and our anger. And part of this is we also have some extra music that I've put in to the service. So you get to hear some songs, because one of the important things about music, as we talked about last week, is that music allows us not only to comprehend it on a verbal and intellectual basis, but it also connects with our emotions, okay? And so often we listen to different types of music because we connect with it on some level. And I said last week that some people consider music to really be the language of the entire world, because you can listen to music in a different language or even music that has no lyrics at all and be connected deeply and have an emotional response based on that music. So let's go ahead and let's read our psalm this morning. And our scripture is Psalm 4. So, for the director of music with stringed instruments, a psalm of David. Answer me when I call you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart his faithful servant for himself. The Lord hears when I call him. Tremble and do not sin. When you are on your bed, search your hearts and be silent. Offer the sacrifices of the righteous and trust in the Lord. Many, Lord, are asking, who will bring us prosperity? Let the light of your face shine on us. Fill my heart with joy when their grain and new wine abound. In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety. So I have a few opening reflections for you this morning. The first one is, what are you most fearful of right now? Are you angry about certain things? so, what? And how are you dealing with both of them? So I'm going to invite you to think and ponder on those as we begin to work through this scripture passage this morning. So as we look at the psalm as a whole, we'll find that again, there's many elements to it. And oftentimes in the Bible, this psalm is given a title of a prayer in distressful times, or a prayer in distress and power of God's confidence. And there's three main sort of topical areas within this psalm. One, we can see lament. We can also see an air of confidence. And finally, we see an instruction given to us about how we can live and work through many of these things. Now, you'll notice that right from the beginning, I've highlighted the words, "Answer me and hear my prayer." And so in this, the psalmist is really beginning to frame the entire first verse by those two phrases. And if we think about that, "Answer me, hear my call," there's a confidence in there knowing that the prayer that the psalmist is lifting up will be answered. But in the middle of that, within the framework of that, there's a cry, a lament. "God, give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me." Now, in the NSRV translation, which is different, this is the NIV, just in case you didn't know, they translate that second part, "give me relief from my distress." The NSRV translates that, "you gave me room when I was in distress." And scholars believe that this can be translated idiomatically to mean, "you widened the path for me when things got narrow." Okay? And so, if you're not sure what an idiom is, it's a phrase that we use that sometimes doesn't have a meaning that we would take at all. So for instance, "it's raining cats and dogs." Okay, that's an idiom. We know that means it's raining really hard, but if you said that to someone that didn't know our language, they'd be like, "what do you mean? There's cats and dogs falling out of the sky?" Like, you know. So again, I find that a very interesting interpretation for them. "You made the way wide when it had narrowed." All right? And so I think that is a powerful indicator of the work that God does. So let's talk about the first emotion of the day, and that is fear. Alright? And if you were to just do a simple Google search or look up in a psychology textbook what fear is, it's often defined as an unpleasant feeling triggered by the perception of danger, real or imagined. Alright? And so again, when Cashin has that fear of bears and I have that fear of spiders, there's an unpleasant feeling we get by thinking about those things, even though we may not see them, but just the thought that they might be there and they might get us, that makes us uneasy. Okay? Now, fear, again, is a very natural emotion for us to deal with. And in fact, it's tied to our fight or flight response, which is a survival mechanism for us as human beings. And so when things scare us, our natural tendency is either to get away from them because they think we might be harmed, or to stay and stand our ground and say, "look, I'm going to fight and protect myself from this thing." So that's why whenever I see a spider, I generally go get a shoe and I take care of that sucker right away, because my fight instinct kicks in. But fear is a natural thing. But there begins to be problems when we allow fear to control us, when we allow fear to move us to places and react in ways that are not healthy. Now, part of the problem, I think, can be identified in some of the same message that the psalmist brings up. And here he's speaking as God, so there's a shift in characters, and he's coming as the psalmist. He switched to God speaking here in verse 2, and he says, "how long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods?" So folks, again, I ask you some of those beginning reflection questions. How are you dealing with this current situation that you find yourself in? For sure, it's an uncertain time. We're dealing with a virus and a COVID epidemic that none of us have seen before in our lives. Some of us fear for our health and our life. What about the political unrest that we see all over the place? What about those of us that have to make decisions about whether to send our kids to school, knowing that their health may be at risk? Or a teacher who has to go back and teach knowing their health may be at risk. And again, could be said for just about anybody that's working in a place of employment. What about those of you that have lost jobs or been furloughed during this time? Some of you might be wondering just how you're going to get through. Will you have the money to pay your bills? Will some of you lose your home? And so fear is a very real thing. Now, interestingly, I've gained a perspective over the course of this, and it hasn't been easy or just that I came to it all alone. But sometimes I think about this exactly when it comes to some of the fear that we're facing. And that is, what if God is tearing down some of the idols that are in our lives? What if we have been pursuing things that aren't focused on Him? You know, all of us, and myself included, seek to live a comfortable lifestyle. We build a lifestyle based around the things that we like, and we like to be comfortable. And right now, none of us are probably very comfortable with all of the decisions that we have to make. God is testing us on what seems to maybe be every aspect of our lives. Many of those I've just listed. But what if God's shaking this up and saying, wake up, people. Wake up, church. See the things that are going on around you. See the things that I'm doing. Not that all of the things that you do are bad, but maybe you've put too much focus on those things. I'll use sports as an example. How many people have been just devastated that we haven't been able to watch sports? I mean, people are going crazy over this stuff, right? We've created a cult of sports in our world today. And again, look at how much these athletes get paid to entertain us. Millions, most of them, or at least the really big ones, get paid millions and millions of dollars just to entertain us. How many of us as parents put our kids in sports from the time they're just little? I have to raise my hand. My kids have been wrestling since they've been in 4K. How much time and energy do we put in getting them to those things? How many of us get upset when we know the Packer game's on and Pastor Josh talks too long and they got to get home to the game?
They're reruns.
They're reruns. Again, is sports bad or wrong? No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that perhaps we spend too much time and put too much focus on things that are merely entertainment. And what could we be doing with that time? Again, to maybe hit the nail a little harder, how many times do we put only an hour of church on Sunday, but we can watch 4 or 5 hours of football on a Sunday? Where are our priorities? Okay? Now again, fear is a natural thing. And again, some of us have very silly fears, but others of us have very real fears. You know, I wonder if I'm making right decisions as I try to lead this church. What happens if I don't? What will people think about me? How will I deal with the consequences of that? Again, when I go to send my kids to school, how am I going to deal with that if they do get sick? So again, fear is not wrong. Fear is real. Now, for those of us that spent time at the Global Leadership Summit, we got to hear a lot about having to navigate the fear factor in our lives and in our leadership. And one of the ways that they encouraged us to do that was when we become aware of fear into our lives, to take time and think about that and then begin to lean in to that fear. Now, immediately that doesn't seem like the right thing to do. That seems like it's very hard to do. And yet all of us at some point in our lives have done that. You know, think about that time that you asked that special person out on that date or to marry you. You took the risk to lean into that fear that you might be rejected. Or think about that first job application that you put in and said, you know what, I really like this job, but I don't know if I'm qualified or if I have the skill set, if I'm the right person. But you got it. And so, folks, that's what I'm going to say, is that in the midst of all of this, in the midst of the swirl of uncertainty, and in the midst of being ripped out of our comfort zones, how do we navigate that fear? Well, I'm going to encourage you to lean into it, just as I was encouraged this last week. To be willing to take the risk to walk boldly forth, saying, you know what, I've evaluated this as best I can, and these are the decisions I'm going to make. And you lean into that fear. Now, one of the difficulties of not leaning into that fear is that fear can sometimes overwhelm us. Okay? And fear can tell us a whole bunch of stories and lies that simply are not true. And so I have a song that many of you are familiar with. I'm going to ask Dale to pull that up for me. But it's a song by Zach Williams called Fear is a Liar. And so in lieu of our songs of summer, I invite you to listen to just the first little bit of this. Just for those of you that are on Facebook Live or are going to be watching the YouTube stream, we probably won't be able to have that on. And so again, Fear is a Liar by Zach Williams. You can just go to YouTube and you'll be able. There's some very powerful lyrics in that about some of the things that happen to us when we allow fear to control us. When we run away or become paralyzed and don't want to make any decisions. Now, we're going to transition here because there's some very powerful wisdom from one of my favorite characters in all of science fiction literature. And the great Master Yoda once said, "Fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. And hate leads to suffering." Okay? It's pretty amazing how well the Jedi knew the importance of controlling their emotions. And if you're ever a Star Wars fan, what does the dark side or the Sith always encourage you to do? Give in to your emotions. Because again, there's a destructive tendency when we give in to our emotions. And so, folks, we're going to transition now, and we're going to look at the emotion of anger. All right? And so, in verse 4 and 5, the psalmist says, "Tremble and do not sin. When you are in your bed, search your hearts and be silent. Offer the sacrifices of the righteous and trust in the Lord." Now, again, in several other Bible translations, that word "tremble" is translated as anger. And I think it's very insightful that the psalmist says, look, when you're mad, when you're angry, don't allow yourself to sin. Okay? One of the problems that we have with anger in our modern age is so oftentimes it's not funneled correctly. It's not controlled and then manifested in a healthy way. All right? So, there's a gospel story about Jesus getting angry. And it's a very powerful story. And if you remember, Jesus walks into the temple one day and he sees that his house, his father's house of worship, has become a marketplace. And Jesus sits on the sidelines for a few minutes just taking all this in, and the anger in him just begins to swell. And we know what he did, right? What's he do? Flips the tables, clears it out, right? Again, he shows and demonstrates his anger in a healthy way. Does he hurt anyone? No. Does he hurt the animals? No. Did he hurt some people's pride? Yeah, probably. He got some people pretty mad at him. But anger is useful when we fight for justice and we strive for righteousness. I've told you that one of the things that angers me most of all is when people hurt kids. All right? And I don't know about you, but there seems to be something very subtle going on right now with the issue of pedophilia and sex trafficking in our country and across the world. And it sickens me and it makes me irate. And so I have to figure out ways to process that anger and then use that anger in a productive manner. All right? I think many of us have seen plenty of instances where people haven't used their anger in a constructive way. I think some of the riots that we have seen, what once was a peaceful protest, turned into just wanton destruction. Again, fear leads to anger, anger leads to hate, hate leads to suffering. I read a news story this week about a woman who threw hot coffee on a man because he wasn't wearing a mask. I watched a video of some guy not wear a mask and just think he was the most entitled person and create a great big confrontation when he was confronted on it. I watched some young adolescents destroy a business because they were irate over something minor that had happened. Folks, when we don't control our anger, we hurt people, and we need to be careful about that. Again, anger is something that's natural for all of us. God put it there for a reason. So let me give you a quick definition of anger, and we'll continue with that discussion. But anger is a strong feeling of annoyance, displeasure, or hostility. Okay? And so we get angry over things that annoy us or that bring us displeasure. Again, anger is tied to that fight-or-flight response. It's tied to that survival mechanism that we have. Anger can also be a mask for pain. And folks, one of the dangerous things I think about anger is that we've created a culture in our world where we're so scared for people to actually exhibit anger that we encourage people to bottle it up and not show it because we're scared of it. And we've seen plenty of examples of where it has manifested in an unhealthy way. But the problem is when we bottle stuff up, when we bottle and compartmentalize anger, it just builds. And then what do we think is going to happen? It's just going to blow up. That person's going to implode from the outside and there's going to be destruction. And so again, what lesson can we learn from Jesus in the temple? What can we learn from this psalm in how to deal with it? So when you're angry, don't sin. When you're on your bed, search your hearts and be silent. Take the time to pause, to step back before you just immediately react. Take time to do the right things, to offer the sacrifices, and even in the midst of that emotion, no matter how strong that is, put your trust in the Lord. Now I've got another song for you here. This is an older song. I have a sneaking suspicion that this is not going to be the genre of music that many of you care for. I'm just going to ask you to have an open mind and listen to a couple of minutes or a few verses of this, because I think it speaks powerfully of what happens when we allow that anger to build in us. Can you get it? So again, like I said, I try not to look at your faces and judge you, because I know that there was many of you that do not care for rap or hip-hop music. But one of the things I do like about rap and hip-hop music is that it's very emotional. You know, the people talk about very deep things in their life, oftentimes the hard things, anger, violence, things that go on, all right? Now, Some of you may think I'm crazy, but my grandma, who was 70 years old at the time and was a major mentor to me, gave me a rap cassette when I was just a little kid and said, here you go. And I think everybody at our church in Kadat just about dropped on the floor. And she goes, what are you doing? Giving your kids rap music, blah, 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 blah. All right? And now again, there's a lot of rap music that I encourage you not to listen to. You know, the lyrics just are not healthy to do. But there's something, again, about being able to appreciate and experience the emotion within various types of music. And so when I listen to that, I could connect and relate to a lot of what he's saying. You know, how many of us, when we feel disrespected or when we feel offended, is our initial reaction to just lash back out at that person, to just let go of that anger and just let that person have it? Or what about in the midst of all this uncertainty when we get angry at the things we see, and as he said, you get those, we carry all the weight of all of these things, and all of a sudden those rocks and those boulders start to shift out of control, and pretty soon we feel out of control. We don't know how to control those. All right? So in the business field, there is a growing field called emotional intelligence, or EQ. Okay? And it's a difficult field to research and do stuff because it's not really defined. It's not like actual intelligence that you can measure. Okay? Emotional intelligence is very hard to define, and it's very hard to kind of research. But it's important, and many more businesses and different organizations are using emotional intelligence to help their employees or to help grow their organizations. And there's three main facets of emotional intelligence that are important and I think are instructive for us to learn about. And so just as the psalmist tells us to sit silently on our beds and to think about these things and then to offer the right sacrifices to God. So emotional intelligence tells us that when we confront emotions, we need an awareness. So all of a sudden, when we have something that hits us and we know that it's there, we have to take time to be aware and say, okay, what exactly am I feeling right now? Am I sad? Am I fearful? Am I angry? What is that? Next, we need to begin to harness those emotions and use them constructively. So again, going back to the example of Jesus flipping over the tables in the temple, if you read the story, you know, like I said, Jesus just didn't walk in and start throwing the place to pieces. He took time deliberately and intentionally to size up the situation. And what he saw disturbed him so much that it moved him into action. And he flips the tables, he scatters the money, he says, get these animals out of here. But again, as the pastor from our global leadership so insightfully said, Jesus never hurt anyone. He never hurt any of the people that were doing this. He never hurt any of the animals that were in the temple. And in fact, I think he takes great care, like, take these doves and get them out of here, the most fragile, gentle creatures that they have. And so, folks, one of the things that we need to do is not only harness our emotions and figure out ways to use our anger and our fear constructively, but we also have to help others do the same. Okay? And that can be difficult sometimes because it requires us to truly put ourselves with other people, to truly be connected, to have empathy for people. We need to learn to read things like body language. You know, there's lots of times that I can see there are things bothering you folks just because I can see it on your face because I've gotten to know you well enough. And so how do we go about helping each other do that? How do we find ways to help each other deal with loneliness or deal with fear or work through our anger? It's a process, just like learning to be aware, just like learning to control our own anger and fear and emotions. Is a process. Now, after he talks about anger a little bit again, he goes on, the psalmist goes on again and says, many, Lord, are asking, who will bring us prosperity? Let the light of your face shine on us. Fill our hearts with joy when their grain and new wine abound. Again, last week we looked at this idea of delighting, of what was the first word that we talked about in the psalm? Bless, or be happy. All right? And folks, I think this resonates today among many people. God, where are you? I just want to be happy. I live in this uncertain, crazy world, and I just don't know how to get through it. How can I find happiness? How can I find contentment when everything around me is crazy? And folks, we need to be a message of hope and love. We need to have the courage to stand up boldly for people and for the things that we value most. But again, the world is desperately looking and searching for a message of hope, especially in these trying times. The psalmist again in verse 7 draws us back. Fill my heart with joy. That joy found only in you. That joy that only you can provide. You're the one who gives me the prosperity, the abundance in my life. And so folks, again, if you see someone with or without a mask, can you have empathy and patience with that person if you're one way or the other? If you're a Republican or a Democrat, can you have empathy and work together? When you see someone spouting off on Facebook and just rambling on and on about this or that, can you have some grace? Can you speak hope into those situations? Can you speak love into those situations? Now, another concept that we talked a lot about at the Global Leadership Summit this year was resilience. And resilience can be defined as the capacity to recover quickly from difficulties or toughness. Again, I ask you the question, how are you doing? I would say many of us have obviously had to learn to at least cope with or figure out new ways to live during this uncertain time. But as we learned this week, resilience is a lot harder when things are good, because many of us, again, have created very comfortable lifestyles. We spend our time working and working to acquire more and more material possessions so that we can live comfortably. We've created a cushion to make us feel safe and secure. And it's tough to create resilience, to create toughness when you're constantly living in that situation. But now that things have been shaken up and we're pulled out of that comfort zone, do we have the resilience to get knocked down and get back up again and keep going? You know, there's a quote in one of the Rocky movies, it's one of the latter ones. Again, I grew up in the 80s and 90s, so just idolized Rocky Balboa and his training scenes, the whole Eye of the Tiger thing. But he's actually having a conversation with one of his sons in the movie, and he says, you know what, no matter how many times life knocks you down, you just got to get back up and keep trying. And folks, again, life is going to knock us down. It's only a matter of time. It's not if, but it's when. And will we have the strength and the courage to get back up? And will we, as we talked about a few weeks ago in Seed Faith, will we allow our faith to continue to grow? Will we allow our foundation to be planted firmly on the rock that is Jesus Christ? Will we allow our roots to continuously dig deep and suck the water from the source of all life? And so, folks, when it comes to resilience, can you find things in your life that you can control? You may not be able to control everything you once did, but I'm going to say there are a few items that you can still control. So find those things. For those areas in your life that you can't control, how can you modify? Again, all of us have been tested in this. And my fear is that some people won't want to modify. And they'll just cease to live. They'll live a life of miserable existence. They'll be by themselves and too scared to do anything. But folks, even in this, and with all of the restrictions and everything we have, we're called to live. So how do we modify our lifestyles now to live and to grow the kingdom in this time and in this place? And folks, how do we keep growing? How do we keep those roots digging deeper and deeper into the richness of that life-giving water. And I don't care if you're 2 years old or you're 92 years old. You're never too old to grow and to learn and to do something. But it requires intentionality. It requires a commitment to say, you know what, I'm going to do that. I don't have it all together. I'm not just going to try to skate through. I need to grow. So again, for a little quiz for you, how are you doing in your scripture reading? How many of you have taken the challenge to read 5 Psalms a day and kept up with it? Good. If you're not, I'm not placing shame on you. I'm just asking you to think about that. How can you this week pour into the scriptures and find the answers, find the instruction and the guidance you need for your life? And that's really what the psalmist ends with. In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety. And so, folks, in the midst of raw emotion, in the midst of uncertainty, we're called to just lie down at the feet of our Heavenly Father, trust and have faith that we are saved, that we are provided for in all of our needs. So friends, God bless. I leave you with a couple of action steps. The first is to just spend some time in prayer and reflection, identifying areas where you may be fearful or have anger. Invite God into these areas and begin cultivating strategies to help deal with and control these emotions. Two, reach out to someone else who may be struggling emotionally. Find ways to share encouragement, hope, and love with them. And then two, as always, continue to just delve into the scriptures. I mean, there's obviously lots of other spiritual disciplines you can do, but one of the greatest ones is just to pour into the scriptures and just seek the guidance and the instruction that God, through His Word, gives us each and every day. God bless. At this time, I would invite you to lift up and share any joys, concerns, or prayer requests that you may have. Difficult and challenging medical conditions. So please keep him lifted up in prayer. Is there anything else this morning? Well, with that, I invite you to continue to lift up and pray for our countries, for our leaders, pray for the upcoming election, pray for our local officials and teachers and administrators that have to make some continued difficult decisions. And support them as best we can. All right, at this time, I invite us to just take a moment of silent prayer. Dear gracious God, we just come to you and we thank you and praise you for this day. This day that we can come and worship you. Lord, right now I just ask that each of us just open our hearts and minds and that we just give the emotions that we have swirling around inside of us to you. Lord, we ask for your guidance and your instruction on how we can constructively use those to enrich our lives. Pursue happiness, to care for others, to build your kingdom. Lord, I thank you for each person here today, for those that will watch and worship with us online. Lord, I just pray that they have had a spirit-filled experience with you this morning. Lord, I pray that we will all continue to grow and continue to build that solid foundation, so that as more uncertain times come, that we will have the strength to stand in the midst and proclaim a message of hope to your world. Lord, right now we lift up and we pray for all of our leaders on each level, all the way from our national level to our very local officials, administrators that we have here. Lord, help us to help them to just do their best work, to continue to navigate the difficult situations and to make the best decisions that they possibly can. Lord, right now we lift up Juanita's brother Dale, and Lord, we just pray for your healing hand to be upon him. Lord, we just ask that whatever is wrong with him, that he will have the strength and the courage to continue to move through that. Lord, we just ask that your healing power flow over and through him. Lord, help his doctors, nurses, and staff to just care for him and to do their very best work. Give support, peace, and comfort to him, to his family members, and all of those that will support him. Lord, we also pray for all of those unspoken requests, all of those things that remain heavy on our hearts. And Lord, we just give those to you this day, knowing that you're already at work in each and every one of them. Lord, we pray that your will be done. We pray that we would see and experience the miraculous results. Lord, be with each of us as we go about this day and about this week. Help us to continue to grow as your disciples. Help us to share the gospel message with those in the world around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
second one. So again, you all knew the song.
Yep.
Cheryl played beautifully, and we were just able to sit and all feel awkward together. So God bless you all. So I apologize for that. So friends, again, indeed, let us trust and obey, for there's no other way. So friends, I hope that we have had our minds open, that we have had our hearts touched. Let us go forth strengthened as we claim our identity as beloved children of God. And may God's promised peace be with us all. Amen. God bless and have a wonderful week. Yes.